All right. Hi, everybody. I'll be talking to you about my proposed master's thesis research that has to do with habitat for native fishes on the San Juan River. I'd like to thank my co-advisors, Dr. Casey Pinnock, Dr. Pedro Booty, and my committee member, Dr. Peter Wilcock. I'd like to acknowledge my funding sources, which are the San Juan River Basin Recovery Implementation Program, the Bureau of Reclamation, USGS, and the Ecology Center. It'll come as no surprise to you that rivers are highly altered worldwide by human activities. Some examples of river alterations are the construction of dams, river channelization, land use alteration, and water extraction. These and other alterations have contributed to the widespread decline of freshwater biodiversity worldwide, and at rates greater than most other biomes. Habitat loss and degradation has been a major driver of this decline in freshwater biodiversity. Habitat is important for fishes because fishes need access to diverse complementary habitats in which to complete their life cycles. For example, fish need suitable habitat in which to spawn, which may be a clean gravel substrate for some species. Young fish also need suitable habitat to survive, such as submerged wood that provides low velocity habitat. Subadults also need suitable habitat in which to feed and grow and reach sexual maturity and complete their life cycle. Rivers with high habitat diversity are often characterized by a complex overall structure consisting of multiple channels. These provide variable water velocities for fish across different habitat types, and some examples of diverse habitats include deep pools, large backwaters, and woody debris. And these specific examples are all examples of low velocity habitats, which are theorized to be very important for many fishes' life cycles. Complex habitat is often formed by high, typically springtime floods that overflood the riverbank and interact with the floodplain, which can act to create additional habitat in the form of side channels and backwaters. These high flows can also shift the channel and recruit wood into the system that provides additional habitat. Unfortunately, habitats have been largely simplified in the Colorado River Basin, and this has contributed to the widespread decline of native fish populations there. And many fish species are now imperiled, including the endangered razorback sucker and endangered Colorado pike minnow. Simplified habitats, on the other hand, are often characterized by a simple overall structure, such as pictured here, which is a single channel. Water velocities are much less variable in simplified systems, and so is habitat, with long stretches of the river consisting of simple, similar habitat. Especially lacking in simplified systems are low velocity habitats, which again are very important for multiple fish species. The San Juan River, which is the second largest tributary to the Colorado River, has experienced substantial habitat simplification, largely due to the construction of Navajo Dam in 1963 and decreases in spring snowmelt due to climate change. These two factors have resulted in the reduction of peak springtime floods and has reduced the river's ability to create that complex habitat. In the simplified system, these reduced springtime flows are not able to overtop the banks, and the floodplain is not interacted with. And this creates little off-channel habitat formation and overall simple habitat within the channel. This lack of interaction with the floodplain has contributed to the encroachment of vegetation on the San Juan River. The top photo is an example of the river showing historical conditions, and the bottom photo is representative of modern day conditions, where non-native vegetation, primarily Russian olive, seen here in the light green, now crowds the riparian area. This is a problem because the roots of these non-native vegetation have armored the riverbanks and have further reduced the river's ability to shift and create that complex habitat. Although wood recruitment in the river is limited due to the fact that the river does not interact with its floodplain, any wood that is recruited into the river may provide habitat for native fishes. Therefore, my first chapter's overall theme is exploring the role of in-stream wood recruitment as a possible avenue to create complex low-velocity habitat for native fishes. The first objective of my first chapter will explore the question, what is the role of natural wood for native fishes in the San Juan River? My hypothesis is that fish densities will be higher near natural wood debris than in habitats away from natural wood debris. To answer this question, I will implement an observational study utilizing an existing long-term seining data set collected by the New Mexico Department of Game and Fish. I will use this data set to compare densities of fishes in habitats with wood compared to habitats without wood. The second objective of my first chapter will explore the efficacy of taking advantage of that non-native vegetation and adding it to the river, with the research question being, will this create complex habitat that can benefit native fishes? This experiment will take place in extreme southeast Utah and extreme northwest New Mexico on the Navajo Nation, on a river extent about 50 river miles long, as shown in the yellow circle. My experimental design will consist of paired reference and treatment areas where bundles of non-native Russian olive wood are added to the treatment and no wood is added to the reference areas. My research hypothesis is that complex habitat is limited in the main channel for native fishes, and the response variables that I will look into are fish densities, which I think will increase with the addition of wood, macroinvertebrate densities and biomass, which I think will increase, and flow velocities, which I think will decrease. In September of this year, I will select 10 sites and add 5 woody structures at each site in the treatments for a total of 50 woody structures. I'll also implement baseline sampling before the installation of the structures. These photos are examples of 2021 when we implemented the first year of this experiment. Again, from 2021, here are some examples of the wood structures. 2022 wood structures will differ in that the wood structures will be larger and also placed in slightly deeper water. In subsequent months after wood installation, we will resample the sites. We will sample fishes using a beach seine. We will backpack electrofish around the wood piles, and we will deploy pit tag antennas to detect uniquely tagged fish. I'll also take measurements of flow velocity and dominant substrate type, and we'll sample macroinvertebrates by doing wood scrubs of the wood piles and sample benthic macroinvertebrates using a kick net. I'll use these data to compare fish densities and macroinvertebrate densities and biomass between reference and treatments. For habitat data, I will analyze patterns of water velocity, depth, and dominant substrate type between reference and treatments. I'll now move into the second chapter of my thesis, which seeks to answer the question, how has riparian vegetation cover and channel area changed over time? River managers have split the San Juan River into 8 distinct geomorphic reaches. This analysis will include reaches 3 through 6, because in other reaches, the river is confined by either the canyon or by artificial man-made structures. I will attain digitized aerial imagery of 3 different time periods, the 1930s, the 1970s, and the 2020s, with historical imagery georeferenced to modern imagery. For channel simplification analysis, I will digitize the active channel in GIS, which will allow me to calculate difference in channel area and width among the time periods. For riparian vegetation analysis, I'll use GIS to create equally spaced transects along the active channel of each time period that denote the presence or absence of vegetation. I'll also supplement current vegetation community by assessing on the ground, by doing on the ground sampling at 5 transects in each geomorphic reach, to determine community composition found there. At each transect, I will identify and enumerate all woody species in a 10 by 20 meter area on both sides of the active channel. From the channel simplification analysis, I will be able to extract total channel reductions among time periods, as exemplified in this pie chart from a similar analysis conducted on the Price River. I'll also be able to report longitudinal changes in channel area, as exemplified by this multicolored river line. Riparian change analysis will similarly allow me to report total changes in vegetation cover among time periods, shown in this made up plot where we have percent vegetation cover on the y-axis and the different time periods on the x-axis, which shows that theorized increase in vegetation cover over time. And this analysis will also allow me to report longitudinal changes in vegetation cover. Riparian composition community investigation will allow me to report what kinds of vegetation are found along the river, as shown in this example plot of proportion of vegetation type on the y-axis and geomorphic reach on the x-axis. And this will visually show if there are differences in patterns in vegetation type among geomorphic reaches. Overall, my first chapter seeks to better inform managers of the role of existing wood for fish habitat in the San Juan River, as well as a native fish habitat enhancement technique that utilizes an existing and abundant resource. This technique is also potentially scalable and could be implemented on a much broader scale on the river. My second chapter will seek to provide managers of an important historical and contemporary context of in-stream habitat on the San Juan River and better inform future habitat enhancement projects. I would like to extend a big thanks to the Navajo Nation for allowing us access to their lands to complete this research. I'd also like to extend a special thanks to Mark McKinstry of the Bureau of Reclamation, who I believe is attending on Zoom today, for his important role in this project, and as well to everyone else who has helped. So thank you all for listening, and I'll take any questions. For the woody addition experiment?
Yeah.
Yes, we are doing the electrofishing and seining.
We do that in both habitats,
though? Electrofishing has only been done in treatment so far.
Okay, sorry. Have you thought about how to account for differences in efficiency of the gear, like comparing abundances or?
Between the two gears, I think the rationale of between not doing the electrofishing and the treatment, is that what you're kind of getting at?
Right. If you're comparing areas where you're only deep sand areas, where you're only like fishing, how are you going to account for different efficiencies of those?
So, in the treatments, we do electrofishing and seining. So, the seining allows for direct comparisons. And we're also doing depletion seining to better inform if there are sampling efficiencies in seining between reference and treatments. But the rationale between only doing the backpack electrofishing and the treatments is that potentially that's how you would sample. That's just one of the best ways to sample within the wood habitat. And there's no wood in the treatments in the reference, so. There's been studies where they've mapped woody debris, and there is woody debris, but not as much as you may expect, given how much woody debris surrounds the river. As far as above the dam, I'm not sure. Does that answer your question? Yeah, so The way I look, I think if I understand it correctly, wood probably wouldn't be super abundant historically, but given that the creation of habitat through flow is becoming less and less, effective, taking advantage of that non-native wood is just a modern attempt of creating that low velocity habitat that is otherwise lacking in the system.
You mentioned that you were altering the configuration of the experimental woody debris setup to move them to deeper water and to make them larger. Is that some changes you've made based on your 2021 observations, or was that always the plan? Just out of curiosity.
Yep, that's adaptive from the first year. Beaver took a lot of our wood the first year, and then low flows contributed to stranding a few of the shallower piles. So that's why they'd be bigger and deeper.
So if you
want to
electrofish first, you're going to catch fish, but you're going to chase the boat. If you sample the frogs first, you're going to chase the fish away.
Yeah, that's a good point. I think the way we've been doing it so far is trying to mitigate disturbance of habitat before we sample it. I think no matter what, there's going to be some interaction of disturbing the habitat before sampling it, except for the first sampling. Maybe we can talk afterward and see what the best order for that would be going forward. Okay. Anybody else? Yeah.
A little more about the partnership with the Navajo Nation. Does that end just at getting access, or is there more of a partnership in terms of the project?
I just received some contact information for the Navajo Nation biologists. I would like to introduce myself to more of the people there. So far, I haven't been interacting with the Navajo Nation as much as I would like.
I'm curious about kind of interaction between your two chapters. Far as like putting wood in the stream could help a grade and provide areas for new riparian vegetation to be established, be it native or invasive. And I'm wondering if you or someone else are going to be looking at that. Yeah, kind of like long term past the current status that you have imagery for. Like, are you going to be affecting the riparian veg?
Yeah, that's a good point. I think the structures that we are implementing for this particular experiment are designed to be ephemeral. And so I think I wouldn't expect any very long-term habitat alterations that would occur to these really small isolated structures. But if it was implemented on a greater scale, that would definitely be vital to that. All right, well, thank you, everybody.